And the people's result, that's dark. Hence. That's interesting. Okay, yeah, because the multiplication is defined on the level of vectors, and in this context, it won't convert that. Okay, this will work, but.
Anyway, Susanna, he's just taking the dot product, he's very cleverly taking the dot product of those two vectors in order to calculate the sum of the ones again.
This will work. Okay, so now I'm picking up the two components of the previous result, calling them A and B, and then I'm multiplying A and B. The reason that it works now is actually weird. I don't understand this, but okay. No, because there's some implicit conversions, and this is one of the most subtle things.
So that thing is just specifying you're using.
Yeah. So what you see here is so let introduces variables. So there's a lots of new things here. Maybe I'm going too fast.
Yeah, so maybe it's my fault. I forced Mark to go ahead of where he wanted to be. So maybe come back to this let business.
Yeah. And there will be lets, but somewhat later. I'm only at the fourth thing. So I said we have lists of numbers. We have matrices, so that's this one. A very small matrix which I can at least remember. It's a matrix with two rows. It's a 2x2 matrix. First row is 1, 2. Second row is 3, 4. So that's a valid object. The value is this matrix. And I can do some linear algebra with it. So I recall the result and I apply it to vector 1. Comes from 143, which I think is correct. So that's just, it now, the 110 is interpreted as a column vector. And it sees a matrix times a vector, it understands that the vector has to be a column, and it does multiplication. The result is a vector. If you look carefully, the spacing here is slightly different than it was for the lists of integers. This is using the internal atlas type vector, which is very similar to rows of integers, but not quite the same. Usually an atlas function it's one of the subtle things which is very old in the language. The language knows about lists of whatever, so in particular lists of integers, but atlas functions need a very specific data type which is used to compactly represent vectors. So lots of atlas functions which want a vector. And because the atlas library doesn't know about the axis language. So the axis language pre-processes this list of integers and say, oh, atlas, it knows about types, atlas wants a vector, so it compresses these integers to a vector object, and it does this implicitly without you having to specify anything. It just knows based on the type that it has to do this conversion, and so this will automatically convert to a vector. But in this case, the bit of a matrix, so this one is actually converted to a vector by implicit conversion. This one is a matrix from the beginning, and after multiplication, it's an internal vector object. And you can see it by the spacing, which has some more space for a vector.
Is there a way to convert that 110 into a vector so we can see the space?
Okay, so 110. 10. And well, if there is a way for these implicit conversions to make them explicit, and that's to give the type you want, and for vector what is that, with a column and then the expression, and now you see it comes out as a vector.
So how can I tell that 110 is an array of integers?
If you really want to see that, you can take 110 and say what type. This again is something that. And so the way it represents a row of integers is bracket in bracket. So a pair of bracket means a list of whatever is inside. So if you list of these things, you get two brackets around them. That's all very natural. Vec and make and not. Notice if you type what type for
the matrix thing. And we'll say much for the matrix. So these compact types, adapters have very short names. The more elaborate, more legal-oriented types will have longer names than the capitalism. That's just something that's historically ground. That's what that makes of it. The very basic types are in, fact, not, string, bool, all with lowercase, and all with short names.
Sorry, one last question. Do you have the matrix multiplication of the vector? Can you do it in the other order?
You can do it in the other order, and in that case, so let me see. So we remove that, and I didn't set. Of course, now it will be a one-row vector, because otherwise the matrix multiplication won't work, and the outcome will not be the same.
So it automatically decides whether it should be a row or a column vector?
Yes, and at the atlas type level, there is no distinction. That's something we might do, because conceptually, all the atlas objects are either rows or columns. Usually they don't get confused. This means that we are not assuming a space with a natural inner product on it. Every time you write in a scalar product, it's a product between a vector. The left hand is always interpreted as a row, and the right hand is always interpreted as a column, if you do a scalar product. And this is important when we're going to talk about roots and co-roots. So roots are columns, and co-roots are rows. So in scalar products, for scalar product, the definition is symmetric. So if you interchange them, the value will not change. But the right thing to do is to put the column to the left and the root to the right, the column weight in general. But I'm getting ahead of myself. So scalar product did that. Let me do another matrix multiplication. So I can do a matrix here, and I need to adjust the swapping matrix and that. So since it's being applied to the right, it should swap the columns, which is what it does. Okay. So that's matrix multiplication, and the type is matrix, obviously. What we can do with that, we can multiply, of course, by itself. You can use dollar more than once. Okay. We can try to raise it to a higher power. The dollar is now the last value, the third power. And now we see, for the first time, the fact that we can use the raw atlas program. Matrix multiplication is built in. Matrix powering is defined in a script. So since I didn't load any scripts, the dollar to the power of 3 doesn't work. There's another thing that's interesting, is that in its reporting, it gives you an expression in a strange form with the power operator to the left and then a pair of operators. This is because formulas are transformed always on input. So it allows the formula in your usual format, but the first thing it does is transforms it into prefix form with the operator being a function applied to a pair of arguments. And since it cannot tell afterwards that this has happened, it just gives you the internal form when it's complaining about. But it says as well, it says to match the operator with the argument type map int. So it tells you it got these two types, which together form a new type. This is a new type, pair type. Pair of a matrix and an integer, and for that type, it doesn't find any definition of the hat operator, so it just doesn't know what to do. Okay, but since this is annoying, at this point, I will at least start to load the basic script, and if not, the extension 80 for Atlas, and basic, this is a lot of functions, and so we have a lot of input here. And so it just readied this whole file basic, and it's resulted in all these definitions, and one of them is matrix column. I don't know exactly, but anyway, if I now do this command again, it now computes the third power. And just to illustrate, I make it even higher power. And this is not right, because you see the matrix has all positive entries, so every power of the matrix should also have positive entries. And so what has happened? How did we get negative entries? This is because the built-in compact matrix types uses machine integers, which can go to 2 to the 31st, and then they overflow and become negative. So it's just something to think about. The compact vector and matrix type do have this problem that they can overflow and they won't tell you. On the other hand, if you use integers, that's something fairly new, and you take a very large one, it will compute that with no problem. Obviously, this will not fit any machine integer. So for integers, it can do actual computation, precise computations, but if you want to put it into a vector, well, if you put it into a row like this, to an row, no problem, because it's a list of integers. But if you want this as a vector, then it says integer to bits. So it does realize that this integer won't fit into a vector.
It overflows for integers also.
Excuse me?
It overflows for integers too.
It doesn't overflow here in the computation, but it really recognizes that the integer won't fit in a vector. But on the other hand, if you do a computation like the matrix power, where the computation is actually not working with integers but with matrix objects, then it just uses the machine operation for multiply, and this happens to overflow without any warning.
So let me answer Jonathan's question. This is my registered Jonathan Fernandez, and sometimes this kind of overflow you will have an integer to bit for conversion. And for us mortals, it just means that somewhere it tried to convert from one thing to another and it couldn't. If you're clever, you can avoid these. And that's part of what Mark's talking about.
Yeah,
but
if
for
this
first,
happens, you
most
might
of the time,
not
you won't
them.
Need to worry about it. Really?
Yeah.
What version of the software are you using?
Must be that big.
Check the version. So this
3 to the 300 type 3
So 3 to the 300. I'm running the same version as Mark, and mine. 3 to the 300 is fine.
I got 0 for 2 to the 1.
Yeah, so this feature...
If you get a high power of 2 equals to 0, then you're sure you still
right.
don't have the large integers.
Yeah, so these large integers are fairly recent. Look at the very... Launch the program and tell me what version it says. It says Atlas version, blah, blah, blah. Sorry. No.
Just the 1.01.
Yeah, that's too old.
Yeah, this is one. I think 0.4 or something. Okay, so
the logic to this is just whether it's bit type, not anything else. Not latency.
We have large integers and large rationals.
Just these two.
Yeah. Well, as long as you build lists of those. Things are right. So you can do your own kind of matrix multiplication where instead of the mod type, you use lists of integers. And
so
then you won't get
overflow.
But you have to define your own multiplication and you have to study more.
So it's like writing your matrix multiplication library yourself.
Yeah.
I understand. Isn't that built in? And not built in, but isn't it in one of the scripts?
Yes, it's in one of the scripts.
We'll revisit
yeah.
it.
It's a bit, because it touches on implicit conversion as well, it's a bit tricky, right? I mean, you can get run into problems if you mind.
This would be a good topic for me in session one of the upcoming session.
So, well, okay, I'm still a very simple thing I wanted to do. So this is the various, so what it does when I said low basic AT, it it runs all these things and all these commands. I can actually show you. I'll show you here the contents of basic. Top. So it's readable. Well, the green is not readable, but the essential things are in green. So it starts defining -1 is -1, and then it defines the hash symbol as different kinds of operators, and defines the function assert twice. Typically, Atlas defines the same name multiple times. That's called overloading, and the only condition is that the argument types must be able to tell them apart. So I have this hash operator, which is a kind of a do-it-all operator. On the one hand, it can make this, so instead of this for loop, I can just say hash 10, and I will magically get a list of 10 integers. And it's actually its own inverse in this case. If I take the hash of that, it means count. That's built in. So that's kind of neat. And if you say the hash of true, well, true is a boolean. So if you must make it an integer, then it's 1. And if you say hash of false, then it's 0. And that is actually this definition here, actually rule B. It says it's integer. If B is the boolean is true, then it's 1, otherwise it's 0. So well, that's a bit the style in which Atlas is built up. There are relatively few operators, but they are used for a lot of different things, sometimes related, sometimes not really related. So that's one thing you have to get used to, but it's fairly neat. Okay, so that was one thing that I wanted to illustrate, and that was, I guess, this definition of first. It says, well, first is a kind of general search, linear search function. It searches over a range of integers. It takes the first parameter limit. And a second parameter is a function that will apply to value 0, 1, 2, etc. up to limit until it finds, it's a function that returns bool, so it applies them until one of them returns true. Then it returns the value for which it did. And if it doesn't find anything, it gives -1. So this is a slightly mystier, I don't want to get too much into the definition, but this loop has a slight strange thing that it says if this condition is true, then return I. That's the usual jump out of everything, out of the function. And so if it finds any value for which it's true, it breaks out of the loop. The value of the loop is forgotten. And the only thing is that the function is going to return I. And if the loop runs to completion, then it's the -1, which is at the end, which is going to be. So the first function is a function that's useful for searches. So what was the example I had prepared? I want to know if 17 to the power 2017 contains 3 digits 9. And so how do I do this? Well, one thing, I need to convert the numeric value to a string.
Say that again, what's the question?
I want to have this value, which I can compute. And I want to know, are there 3 consecutive nines there? Of course, you can see that there are 3 consecutive nines, but I want to know where. So what do I do? Well, one of the things is that I can do $.toString. toString of this number. Just returns the same thing as a string. String is one of the fundamental types. It cannot do too many things with strings, but one thing it can do with strings is slice a substring. So suppose I want to know, it begins here, suppose I want to know the 10 first characters of the string, then I say, well, $ is my string, and I want to know it up to number 10. I can be more explicit, I want it from 0 up to 10. There again, it's the usual C Python type convention that the lower bound is included and the upper bound is excluded. So this will give you the first 10 characters, and it will return them as a string. And so I want to know, does 999 occur anything? So, okay, so, okay, I'll do this again, and then I set string equals to string of that. Okay, so now this is somewhat like the let, except that this is a global variable. I'm now saying I want to keep this value, at least convert it to a string. I want to keep this string and call it str, and it's now available. It replies and it introduced a variable of called str and has type string. It doesn't print the value, but if you want the value of it, just ask for that. Str equal print as a string. Bit large, and so now I'm going to search in this string. So what do I do? Well, this function first is going to do that. First had two arguments. The first was the number of values I want to test. Well, I don't know how long str is. I'm searching for a string of three characters, so the starting position can be how many different starting positions? Well, there could be that many minus two. Otherwise, if I take one of the last two characters, I would get overflow. And then, so I want to know is str from I to, I'm making an error here, but I plus 1, whether that's 999. Okay, so I'm definitely making an error here, but let me do it first like this. It says, well, you're using an undefined identifier I. This is because I needed a function, and I just wrote down an expression, so there's a very easy way to make this expression into a function of I, is to precede it with int I colon. Now, expression preceded by parentheses, which suggests a function around the argument. Argument is called I, and now it's a function that tests a position I. And now it says yes, a position 2271 is the first occurrence of this. So let's just check that. 2270 to 2280, just to get some context. And you see. So it can do some basic strip processing.
Yeah. First use a fact and then a column to convert the array to
But this is different. This is different. So the column means all kinds of things. So that's one of the things. It can be used in what you're talking about is called cast. It's a type column value, and it means take the value and force it to be a given type. But here the column, the column also means in a range, in this arrows, I think.
Over here you use a function toString to convert type.
Yeah?
You convert a large
integer. ToString, yeah, but toString is not an implicit conversion, it's an explicit conversion. ToString is an explicit function. It's not a keyword or something, it's just a defined function. And well, I'm going to just... it's a built-in function. Okay. It will turn... it's an exception. I thought it was a function that maps integers to strings, but it's a function. It's a function, but it will not be found because it's a kind of generic function.
I mean, will the str column that integer also work?
No, if I convert the integer to a string, it just won't. I can try this string. And it says, I found it while the string was reading. So it understood what my question was. My question was take the value 567 and force it to be a string. But that's not one of the implicit conversions it now has. There's a very limited number of implicit conversions, and it's like usually it doesn't change the interpretation much. It's an implicit conversion, for instance, from integer to rational. If you take an integer 3 and you want to see it as a rational, it can do that and says, okay, that's 3 over 1.
Then maybe you should do that example. You do an integer like 2.
2. And then you can also say rat of 2, and then it's 2 over 1. But if you want then the integer of this, it says it can't. So this is the one way. You cannot implicitly convert any rational to an integer. And there's a function that will do this, but you have to call it explicitly. There's a function floor, which you can use. And that will take this largest integer smaller than a rational number, and if it's actually in the flat scene. But it's not the same thing as an implicit conversion. Yeah?
When you wrote an integer and then you wrote dot, to string, can you do that for every function?
You could almost turn almost any value into a string. Is that what you mean?
No, you just, instead of writing to string, open paren, and then putting in the value,
yeah?
Can you do the value dot to string?
Yeah.
Does that work for every function?
Yeah, that's. Did I do that at some point?
Well, you started to and then you erased it.
Yeah.
That comes later, but yes.
Yeah, okay. So that's just one of those input processing things. Instead of f of x, which of course we can't do, but let me see, floor of 2 over 1. More interesting than a 3 over 7 over 4. One, and instead of that, I can also do this dot floor.
And then my second question is, if you have an object, can you quickly see all the functions that you can apply to it?
No, because basically, if you know its type, any function defined for that type could be applied. And
is there a way to like list them like a help command? Yeah.
There is no help system. I was coming to help actually quite a bit later, but now you're asking. There is no help system. One of the features I was going to do is typing help, and that won't work. It will just say it doesn't know about an identifier called help. So that's basically not the way to do it. So there's things like what type. It can kind of give some inspection of what it knows about. But if you want help on the system itself, there's two files inside the script directory which are helpful. So let me go into the script directory here. Scripts. Okay, so that's a lot of files, but here's two files that have help in them. Actually, 3. Atlas help, which are really open. So Atlas help is basically a manual for the Atlas program. It's a very long file. It's 2,000 lines or something. It's way too large, but it tries to do everything at the same time, the reference manual and an introduction. So it starts with an introduction. Actually, it starts comparing with FOCO, because that was at the time the main difference. So it's a kind of a bit dated, so it should really be rewritten as a reference manual and an introduction separately. But anyway, if you want information, if you want to know about for loop syntax, it should be there. Probably that's a bad way to search for for. It might be somewhere. It's a long file. So for instance, let me see, implicit conversion. That's something that I could, if you want to know which are the implicit conversions, I'll try to implicit conversions. See below. Implicit conversions. Well, so when it actually happens, that probably is a relatively different case. And so you really have to. But anyway, the help is there on all kinds of stuff. But here's where it's implicit type conversion. That's why I didn't find it. So I didn't talk about implicit conversion, implicit type. So you have between vector and row of int, between matrix and row of vector. That's always by columns. Matrix and row of int. Again, by columns. Into rational, I talked about it. There's a rep vector type for rational vectors, but which is somewhat similar to lists of rationals, but thin. And so, see, there's some other conversion, but that's the complete list of all implicit conversions. There aren't any other ones. So this kind of stuff is in Atlas help, and then there's Atlas functions help. So Atlas functions help, and this is a list of all, I hope, all built-in functions. Because built-in functions aren't documented anywhere else. For user-defined functions like in basic.at, you can at least look at a definition. But the built-in ones, all you've got is usually one-line description. For arithmetic operators, I think it's usually sufficiently clear once you know which operation is meant, but well, for some functions, there's more subspace normal, a little bit complicated, and it's a very long list of functions. Some of them very useful, some of them are just historically there. So that's where you find where the built-in functions are. There is some help from the readline system. If you think, well, I know a function, it starts with I, but what could it be? Then you say I tab, hit tab twice, and then you get everything it knows about the letter I. Whether it's function, keyword, type, whatever. Anything that probably could be valid input that the system knows about, it will list. Well, for the letter I, it's a pretty long list. Some of the letters are shorter. So that's one way to get some information. This is really just a read line. The read line says that if you type something, do, then it knows about these four things. Do itself, don't, and done. That's the whole list. But of course, this only helps if you already know what it's called.
What if you did this, and let's say we wanted to know more about the function down to, is there anything we can type right into the?
Well, down to, no. So that basically if it's a variable or an object, something you can type what type. I'll try to do it down to. Actually, I think I don't type. Actually,